Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor D. Velmurugan, the University Grants Commission Basic Scientific Research Faculty from Center of Advanced Study in Crystallography and Biophysics, University of Madras, Guindy Campus, Chennai. Today we are going to talk on module dealing with Laue diffraction, Laue equations and Ewald sphere construction. These are all for the paper Biocrystallography. So students, let us see what we are going to learn in this module, or in other words, what is the objective in this module. First, we are going to study Laue diffraction. What do you mean by Laue diffraction? What is the difference between Laue diffraction and Bragg diffraction and so on? So Laue diffraction, the crystal is kept stationary and the incident wavelength doesn't belong to a single wavelength. It is a white radiation. A combination of different wavelengths are there. Only important thing is the crystal is kept stationary. We are going to see that this crystal diffracts these X-rays of different wavelengths, and we are going to get the spots on the screen. But the beauty is that here the spots will be of elliptical in nature. Then we are going to derive a set of three equations which are known as Laue equations. So Laue, during the derivation, initially he has assumed the Miller index HKL as a non-integral or anything. He doesn't call them as integrals. But when you talk about the condition of a diffraction, he proves that the diffraction is possible only when HKL are integers. This is a beautiful, elegant derivation given by Laue equation. When Laue derived the equations, his intention was just to prove that crystals diffract X-rays and what are the conditions to be obeyed for a reflection. That's all. So he never thought about the condition for producing diffraction maximum. That was done later by Bragg's law. So when you talk about Bragg's law, this is coming from the contribution from the father Henry Bragg and the son Lawrence Bragg. So they observed Laue equation, they extended it further, and in addition to solving many molecular structures using this X-ray crystallography, they gave a simple proof that the conditions for diffraction maximum is simply given by an equation 2d sin theta equals n lambda, where dhkl gives you the interplanar spacing, that is the perpendicular distance between two planes, and on one plane the X-rays are incident, just like reflection, it is getting reflected on the same plane. And you can consider one more ray, that's also getting diffracted. But if you look at the path traveled by the first ray and second ray during incidence and during diffraction, the second ray will be undergoing an extra path travel compared to the first ray. Then they derive what is the extra path. And now the diffracted waves are coming out. They will be like interference phenomena. These waves will produce a constructive interference only when the path difference is integral multiples of wavelength. Therefore, they arrived at a single equation 2d sin theta equals n lambda, where theta is a glancing angle and lambda is a wavelength incident. Then we are going to see the Ewald sphere. Now, in crystallographic experiments, the crystal is not stationary. For example, if you take an oscillation picture, the crystal is allowed to oscillate about 5 degrees above the mean positions. And we keep a photographic film, and once the film is taken out and developed, we can find the mounted axis. And we can measure the mounted axis and also the symmetry. Then we talk about movement of the crystals through 180 degrees. And where the camera cassette will also be moving. So in this case, we talk about Weissenberg photographs. Different layers can be taken and so on. So these are examples I'm giving, because in these cases, the crystal is made to either oscillate or rotate. So when the crystal is rotating, what happens is, along with it, the reciprocal lattice will also be rotating. If this is the case, what is the condition for any point, or what is the condition for Bragg reflection to occur? Whenever the reciprocal lattice cuts a sphere known as Ewald sphere, then that cutting point undergoes or satisfies Bragg's law. So this is our Ewald sphere. This is geometric construction which you will see later. Now for Laue diffraction, Laue used flat plate film for recording the diffraction pattern of a stationary crystal when he used the unfiltered X-rays to be incident on the crystal. In his method, the Bragg equation is satisfied by effectively varying lambda utilizing the beam of continuous radiation, because when you have continuous radiation, all types of wavelengths will be there. The crystal acts as a filter, selecting the correct wavelength for each reflection according to the equation given by Bragg's law, 2d sin theta equals lambda, we have set n equals 1. Now, from the Laue photographs, what can we observe? Symmetries can be observed. Laue derived three equations as necessary conditions for producing diffraction pattern, and Bragg's law can be derived from these equations. In 1912, Max von Laue took the diffraction pattern when a still crystal is incident with a beam of continuous rays. So when you say continuous rays, it is unfiltered X-rays. So we have different wavelengths entering into the crystal. If you look at the figure, there is a central spot which is coming due to the lead stop to absorb the direct beam. As I told in the beginning, the crystal is always stationary in Laue photograph, and also incident beam is continuous X-ray. Laue diffraction. The film used by Max von Laue was a flat plate one. The Laue photograph contains ellipses of varying intensities, and the ellipses have one end of their major axis at the center of the photographic film. You can see this in the enclosed picture. By the by, Laue received the Nobel Prize for this discovery, that when X-rays pass through crystal, the crystal diffracts the X-rays. The spots in each of these ellipses are due to reflections from planes that lie in one and the same zone. Look at the figure enclosed. This figure shows a zone axis Z prime for a given Bragg angle theta. So this Z prime more or less cuts the vertical axis of the cone. R can be considered as a reflected ray, and if one imagines the rotation of the crystal about the zone axis Z prime, which cuts the cone with a semi-vertical angle theta, now the reflected beam with it is carried away, and we can simulate the effect of the zone. Now the rays like R generate a cone coaxial with the Z prime axis with a semi-vertical angle theta. So the center spot is marked near the film, and crystal is again assumed to be stationary. If you look at the spot shapes in Laue diffraction, they are like ellipse. Eventually, when a circle cuts a plane, because the central, the whatever screen you are keeping, the film, it is a plane. So whenever a circle cuts a plane, the shape will be an ellipse, and this is the reason why a general appearance of the spots of the Laue photographs is of ellipse in shape. Since synchrotron uses a wide range of wavelengths, and since Laue experiment involves not the monochromatic light but white radiation, mixture of all wavelengths, synchrotron radiation is ideally suited to the Laue method of recording diffraction pattern. Laue equations. Laue has derived three equations which show the condition for diffraction. So let us just look into the figure enclosed here carefully. Consider X-ray scattering by two atoms, one O and the other at A. O is considered as origin of the crystal lattice, and the scattering of X-rays by O is affected by those scattered by atom A, whose coordinates with respect to O are at PA1, QA2, RA3, where P, Q and R are integers. Therefore, the position OA is simply written as PA1 plus QA2 plus RA3 as given in equation 3.1, where A1, A2 and A3 are the vectors defining the unit cell of the crystal lattice. If you look into the figure, S0 is the incident direction and S is the diffracted direction for the first ray. The second ray is also hitting at atom A and is getting diffracted. But if you look here, the second ray hitting at A and the first ray hitting at O, they do not travel the same distance, because if you drop a perpendicular from O to the line passing through A, we find the second ray has to travel an extra distance of AU. Similar is true for the diffracted rays also. The diffracted ray from O goes along S, then we have diffracted ray from A also going. To find the path difference from O, you can drop a perpendicular which touches at V along the direction of the diffracted ray going from A. Now, this AV is the extra path traveled by the diffracted ray. So, what I want to say is, so when these rays are incident at O and A, they will not be in phase because they have different path difference. So, Laue wanted to calculate what will be the phase difference due to this extra path difference, so which we will see later. Assume lambda is the wavelength of X-ray incident and let S0 and S be the unit vectors, which means that mod S0 equal to 1, mod S will be the 1. That's the definition of unit vectors. So, this S0 represents the incident X-ray beam and S represents the diffracted beam. Now, if you look at the figure, S0, S and OA in general are not coplanar. As you know, O is one atom, A is another atom, and S0 and S may be in one plane, but OA is in another plane. So that is why we talk S0 to be non-coplanar. Now, we are interested in the conditions under which diffraction will occur. For this, one has to determine the phase difference between the rays scattered by the atom O and A. If you just look at the figure, you can see that in the right-hand side, we talk about incident rays. Then, in the left-hand side, these are diffracted by points O and A. So, if you drop a perpendicular from O to the ray passing through A in the incident direction and also to the ray getting diffracted through A, we easily see that there is a path difference between the incident direction and the diffracted direction. Therefore, the second ray is traveling an extra path compared to the first ray. So, whenever there is a path difference, for example, if we take a sine wave, a path difference of lambda corresponds to a phase difference of 2 pi. Therefore, this path difference, conventionally called delta, should have a phase difference. Now, again, look at the figure, what we have seen now. The OU and OV are wavefronts perpendicular to the incident beam and the scattered beam respectively. The moment the incident ray S0 touches O, secondary wavefront started going in the direction perpendicular to it. And if delta denotes the path difference of the rays scattered by O and A, already we have seen what is the extra path traveled by the rays passing through A compared to the rays passing through O. Let this delta be denoted as UA plus AV, which is simply OM plus ON, because AU equals OM and your ON equals AV. But if you look at this OM, this is nothing but the projection of OA along S0, which means that OM can be replaced by S0 dot OA, because these are vector, a scalar product of vectors. Now, so then what is the ON? ON is the projection of OA along minus S, because S is the diffracted ray, or scattered ray. But S is going up, now minus S is going down. So that is the indication, because the vector, the sign is important. So now I say ON is the projection of OA on minus S, which means simply On equals minus S dot OA. So in effect, your delta equals minus OA dot S minus S naught as given in equation 3.2. Now, in general, a path difference of lambda corresponds to a phase difference of 2 pi radians. You can consider any wave motion. And hence, what will be the path difference of this delta in terms of phase difference? So if the phase difference is phi, then the phase difference caused by delta is nothing but 2 pi by lambda times your delta. So which is nothing but when you substitute 3.2, it is minus 2 pi times S minus S naught over lambda dot OA as given by equation 3.3. Diffraction is now related to the reciprocal lattice by expressing the vector S minus S naught over lambda as a vector in that lattice. So let S minus S naught by lambda equals HB1 plus KB2 plus LB3. So we are not assuming anything about the values of HKL, whether integral or non-integral. And this B1, B2, B3 are the unit cell translations of the reciprocal lattice. So that you got to remember. And also, S0 is the incident vector, S is the diffracted ray, reflected ray, where this incident ray S0 is incident at an angle theta to the HKL plane. So we can see it in this figure enclosed. Now we look at 3.4. This S minus S0 vector, you can see from the figure that it bisects the angle between S0 and S. The above equation is now in the form of a vector in the reciprocal space. But at this point, no particular significance is attached to the parameter H, K and L. Already, we have an equation S minus S0 by lambda equals HB1 plus KB2 plus LB3, we call it a 3.4, which we are going to use. Now, these H, K and L are continuous variables and may assume any values, integral or non-integral, at this stage. Now, we are going to substitute equation 3.1 for OA, which is nothing but OA equals PA1 plus QA2 plus RA3, where A1, A2, A3 denote the vectors corresponding to the unit cell of the crystal lattice, and P, Q and R are the integers. So now, you substitute in equation 3.1 for OA and equation 3.4 for S minus S0 by lambda. So now, the equation 3.3, which is a phase difference phi equals minus 2 pi by lambda times S minus S0 dot OA, that now becomes simply phi equals minus 2 pi times HB1 plus KB2 plus LB3 dot PA1 plus QA2 plus RA3, then making use of the dot product of the direct lattice and reciprocal lattice parameters, we simply get this value to be minus 2 pi times HP plus KQ plus LR as given by equation 3.5. Now, the diffracted beam will be found only if reinforcement occurs. And this requires that the phase difference phi has to be an integral multiple of 2 pi, which means that HP plus KQ plus LR occurring in equation 3.5 should be an integer for obtaining a diffracted beam. When can this happen? Already we have seen that P, Q and R are integers. So to make HP plus KQ plus LR as an integer, the only choice is H, K and L have to be the integers. And this is proved by Laue. Even though initially we assume HKL may be integral, non-integral, but to satisfy the relation that constructive or reinforcement to occur, we have to have H, K and L to be integers. So this is waves are in phase now. Now we have arrived at the condition for diffraction, namely the vector S minus S0 by lambda ends on a point in the reciprocal lattice, or that S minus S0 by lambda should be equal to the reciprocal lattice vector capital H, which is also equal to HB1 plus KB2 plus LB3, where HK and LR now restricted to integral values. So now you can derive both the three Laue equations and Bragg's law from the above equation. How to get the Laue equation from equation 3.6? You just have the dot product of each side of the equation 3.6 and the three crystal lattice vectors A1, A2, A3 successfully. For example, using 3.6, I can write A1 dot S minus S0 over lambda will be simply A1 dot HB1 plus KB2 plus LB3. Knowing the properties of this direct and reciprocal cell parameters, this will give you simply H. In other words, if you want to take lambda to the right hand side, A1 dot S minus S0 will be equal to H lambda. Similarly, by taking dot product of A2 and A3 respectively with 3.6, we get two more equations. A2 dot S minus S0 will be K lambda and A3 dot S minus S0 will be L lambda. All the above three equations, 3.7, 3.8 and 3.9 are called Laue equations. All the three Laue equations must be simultaneously satisfied for the diffraction to occur. Thus, Laue not only discovered that this crystal diffracts X-rays, but also proved mathematically that a diffraction spot, HKL, will occur in the reciprocal space only when the above three equations derived by him are satisfied simultaneously. Now let us see how Bragg's law can be derived from the above Laue equation. As shown in the figure, the vector S minus S0 bisects the incident beam S0 and the diffracted beam S. And the diffracted beam S can therefore be considered as S minus S0 being reflected from a set of planes. In fact, equation 3.6 says that S minus S0 is parallel to the reciprocal lattice vector capital H, which is in turn perpendicular to the planes HKL. If theta is the angle between S or S0 and these planes, then since S and S0 are unit vectors, I can write simply S minus S0 equals 2 sine theta. Therefore, 2 sine theta by lambda will be simply S minus S0 over lambda, which I am calling it as H. Since the reciprocal lattice vector, I am just calling it as 1 by D. D is the D spacing. So now, taking D to the left hand side and lambda to the right hand side, we simply get 2D sine theta equals N lambda. So this is the condition for diffraction. The total path difference should be integral multiples of wavelength. We will see it later when we talk about Bragg's law. Let us see what I mean by Ewald sphere. The conditions for diffraction expressed by equation 3.6 may be graphically represented by the Ewald construction as shown in the enclosed figure. By the by, this was done by Professor Ewald. The vector S0 over lambda is drawn parallel to the incident beam and it is of length 1 by lambda. The terminal point O of this vector is taken as the origin of the reciprocal lattice drawn to the same scale as the vector S0 over lambda. If you look at the circle, capital H subscript HK is marked. This is the reciprocal lattice vector and it hits the Ewald sphere at a point P of HKL, which means that P undergoes diffraction. So P is a diffraction spot. So the whole sphere is known as sphere of reflection. The radius of the sphere is 1 by lambda. So the refracted ray is along CP. So now C is the initial point of the incident beam vector. So the condition for diffraction from the HKL planes is that the point in the reciprocal lattice touches the surface of the sphere and the direction of diffracted beam vector S by lambda is found by joining C to P. So now, Ewald sphere elegantly gives you what is the direction of the diffracted ray, how the reciprocal lattice cuts a point in the Ewald sphere, which will be a condition for Bragg reflection. Now, what you do is the experiment, you are rotating the crystal. When the crystal is rotated, the reciprocal lattice also rotated. So various points in reciprocal lattice will be in contact with the sphere of reflection. Whenever there is a point cutting the reciprocal lattice on the sphere of reflection, then that stage we have a Bragg reflection occurring. When this condition is fulfilled, the vector OP equaling to both capital H subscript HKL and S minus S naught over lambda satisfies the equation S minus S naught over lambda equals H equals HB1 plus KB2 plus LB3. So now H is known as the reciprocal lattice vector, and this S minus S naught, as you know, S naught is the incident vector, is a unit vector, and S is the direction of a diffraction, this is again the unit vector. Now this S minus S naught vector bisects the incident direction and the diffracted direction. So in arriving the formula, we have made use of the property between the lattice constant in the real space and the lattice constant in the reciprocal space. Since diffraction depends on a reciprocal lattice point touching the surface of the sphere drawn about C in the Ewald sphere construction, this sphere is known as sphere of reflection. The common methods of X-ray diffraction are differentiated by the methods used for bringing reciprocal lattice points into contact with the surface of the sphere of reflection. The radius of the sphere may be varied by varying the incident wavelength, and that is known as Laue method. Or the position of the reciprocal lattice must be varied by changing the orientation of the crystal, as I told you in the earlier situations, by rotating the crystal and like in powder diffraction. So students, now let us summarize what we have learned in this module. We have seen that the simple Bragg's law can be verified from considering the three Laue equations and determining the intersection points of the three cones. Bragg's law can also be verified using Ewald sphere construction, confirming that a reciprocal lattice point cutting the sphere of reflection will obey Bragg's law. So this is the end of the module. Thanks.